the DSO model and services and the service definitions in general. Now, the next thing to discuss is healthcare and the question, how is healthcare different from other service industries? As discussed yesterday, services are big, half to three quarters of modern economies. The big service sectors are travel and tourism, banking and finance, retail and wholesale, healthcare and welfare services, and many others. Now, as we said yesterday, the management of services is not as precise and developed as the management of manufacturing. So there is a challenge for us to develop these methods. Now, within the service sector, healthcare has a little bit special position in many ways, and this special features is what we want to discuss this morning. So can you, say, manage the health service sector in the same way as you would run a hotel or a bank or a retail outfit or a chain store or things like that? The answer, obviously, is that yes and no. To some extent you can, to some extent you can't. So let's start from the beginning. We said yesterday that the current definition of services is the service dominant logic and the resource integration model. It says that services differ from manufacturing primarily because the customer gets involved in production, but also in many other ways. So a customer can get involved in person, like if you go to a barber shop or to a hospital, you have to be there yourself live. You can also get involved through your property. So if you take your car or your motorbike to a repair shop, you are not going to be there, you don't have to be there in person, but it's still a service in the sense that you are represented by something that you own. Since it's your car, it's you who has smashed it, it has all the idiosyncrasies that come from the fact that you have been driving it. So it's a sort of individual car that belongs to you, and it's your car who is involved. And same is true in case of, say, if you have an insurance and you make an insurance claim, then you are involved through the data. So the data about you and your situation, your policy, whatever happened to you, is the thing that then sort of integrates with the producer's resources. So not all services need to be in person. You can also be represented by a property and data about you. So in health services, you can say that the basic setup is that we have a person who is sick or injured and needs help. We call this person a patient. That's a standard word. I don't know where it comes from, but it indicates that if you are a patient, you need to be patient. Then we have the service provider, who is then somebody who can or is thought to be able to provide help to these problems. So from that follows a care relationship between the healer and the patient, and a care process where you have several steps that are taken in order to solve the health problem. So far, so good. Then it stands to reason that if the patient feels that the healer is helping and the problem is solved or she eased up, then it stands to reason that the patient is willing to pay for it. And it also stands to reason that if the healer is a professional who has some professional equipment or substances or facility or training or education, he or she needs to get paid. So that creates a sort of buyer and seller relation like in any other marketplace. You have a commercial transaction and a market. So what's the problem? Why can't we say have in healthcare ordinary market relationships where you would have this kind of situation where the market price is negotiated? Now this is basic microeconomics that you should know. In all sort of transactions, people buy and sell, there are two interests that bump into each other. The buyer has the interest to pay as little as possible, to buy as cheap as possible, something that is maximally good. So the sort of the buyer wants to maximize his or her utility by paying a little for very valuable products or services. Like a mirror image, then the seller wants to get a high price for something that is cheap to produce. So this is very human, very, very natural. It's always is like that. What is important here to know is that this is true also for non-market transactions. So if the seller is a public producer, a government hospital, then this conflict of interest is also true. Even though the government does not have ordinary bookkeeping and they don't report the profit. But still, even the government, they want to get on with their job as easily as possible and get done whatever they need to done and get paid then by the taxpayers as much as possible. So the interest is similar, although it takes a little bit different shape if the seller is a public body compared to if it would be a market player. So according to classical microeconomics, you have the negotiation of the price and eventually the market clears with the equilibrium price that is acceptable to both parties. So it's acceptable to both parties if the seller can say that, okay, this covers my costs and gives me a reasonable margin, so I'm happy with that. The patient or the buyer is happy if he said, okay, this I can afford. The service was good anyway. I could have even paid a little more, but this price is good for me, so let's go for that. So this is ordinary market mechanism. Now, the question then is, can this be used in health services? And the answer is that yes and no. In many cases, it cannot be used. So health services cannot, like travel and tourism or hotels or banks, cannot rely on the market mechanism. There need to be something else. And there are two fundamental reasons for this. The first reason is on the patient side, which comes down to the fact that in many health problems, the patient cannot be a sort of rational buyer or make a rational choice in the same way as you make more or less rational choices. If you're out there shopping groceries or buying a car or buying a house, you do all these mental calculations in your head and you try to make as smart a deal as you can. In health services, this is in many instances not possible. It comes down to this joke, which is written there, that shrouds have no pockets. You know what a shroud is? Do you use that in India? It's a sort of cloth that dead body is wrapped in a sort of cloth before it's buried. So the shrouds, there's no pocket for your wallet. It means that you cannot take your money with you to the other side. Even if the Chinese think that they can take if they burn some money. Okay. But in real world, you cannot take anything on the other side. That's why the buyer is not necessarily rational. I mean, if you are scared, you're afraid of dying, you are in pain, you pay whatever it takes. Or if it's a family member, your child, somebody, you still, you know, you make decisions that would not be considered rational in any other market because you are panicking. And you are scared. So for these reasons, the buyer is fundamentally in a weak position. Then, on the seller side, as yesterday we discussed, in services, you sell only promises. You sell value propositions. In health services, it's very, very much true that you can only sell promises. No doctor in his or her right mind would make sort of legally enforceable promises of certain kind of health outcomes. And say that, okay, you are sick, you pay me money, and I swear I will make you good. You can't do it because health services are limited by a number of risks and uncertainties. So nobody can know how a cancer will work out. Even if the doctors do their best, sometimes life cannot be saved. So this kind of enforceable promises cannot be made. You only make ordinary promises. I do my best. I'm the best doctor around here, and I do my best, so please trust me, pay me. So there's a situation where the buyer side is irrational or forced to be irrational, and the seller side cannot sell anything but promises. What kind of market exchange is that? I mean, it's bound to be very weird. And what happens and has happened through human history is that this creates an opportunity of predation. So the healer can behave like a predator and, you know, make promises here and there and try to impact, you know, scared people and have them pay too much for nothing. So predation. Now, societies in general cannot accept too much predation because it's instabilizing society. It affects people's sense of what is right and wrong. And that's why healthcare through human history has been regulated by a very sort of strict set of religious and social norms. In the Western world, there is the Hippocratic oath. It is that every doctor has to swear an oath before they get their legitimation that I'm going to devote my life to the care of patients and first of all do no harm and so on and so forth. They have to swear that they will follow certain kind of professional code and not use the opportunities of predation. Now, of course, we know that they don't always follow this, but nevertheless, the society has put this kind of system in order to restrict and limit and control the opportunity of predation. Do you have this in any other businesses? Fruit sellers, cobblers, tailors, they don't swear any sort of professional oath. Why? Because if you're a cobbler and you make bad shoes, then your customers will come after you with sticks and stones and beat the heck out of you if you cheat them. Why? Because anybody can, you know, see the difference between a good quality and bad quality shoe. But who can see the difference between a good quality and bad quality health service procedure? So the market, for these reasons, doesn't work very well. And now, I'm sorry, we have to jump to what's it? 195. This picture is picture number 98. It's a different place on the. But anyway, this is a reason why in the world health systems there are very few instances of markets. Most health systems in the world are. It's on page 98 in your book. in most. 98. So we look at the different health service systems in the world. If you divide them by how healthcare is financed and how it's produced, so you can have private solutions, and you can have public solutions. Now, private-private solution is closest to an ordinary market. That would mean a sort of out-of-pocket that you pay money, cash, to the doctor as much as the doctor asks for. This is the reality in many parts of India and other developing countries. I think, I haven't the most recent figures, but I think out-of-pocket is about half of the Indian health service market. The rest is private insurance and then there are some government or civil servant things. But India in that sense is a sort of odd place in the world that there is a lot of out-of-pocket payments. And if somebody in your family gets sick, then you sort of go and collect cash from all the family members and then put it in a plastic bag and then you go and select yourself a hospital and a doctor and say, okay, our grandma is sick, you know, please do something, here is the cash. While in other parts of the world, the other opposite is in the UK, what is known as the beverage model, where health finance is 100% tax-based and service production is almost 100% based on public organizations that have the budgets from the state. They do the services. In the Nordic countries, we have a similar kind of beverage model, although, say in Finland, about 25% of the finance comes from private sources. You have to pay an appointment fee, which is not sort of the real cost of the doctor's visit. You pay something like 20 euros, while the production cost is 60 or 100 or something like that. But you have to pay something to keep people from using too much of services. So, but 75% comes from the tax finance system. Then there are many different kind of combinations of this. In the United States, there are many different systems, but the sort of largest part is private insurance, which means that you take an insurance, a health insurance, typically your employer is paying it, and then if you are sick, then the doctor's bills are paid by the insurance companies. Then in Central Europe, there's something called the Bismarck model. Bismarck, the German, the founder of the German state, that is based on private insurance, where there are a number of privately held insurance companies that compete among themselves for the business that comes from individual citizens. But in the Bismarck model, the insurance companies are heavily regulated. They are, for example, in the Netherlands, they are not allowed to make profit. They are not allowed to reject any prospective customers, which they can do in the United States. In the US, if you go and try to buy a health insurance, they will ask or put you into a medical examination, and if you have some which is known as a pre-existing condition. So you have had an episode of cancer, or you have broken a bone or something, then it's written down, and the insurance company says that we cover everything but the stuff that is related to this pre-existing condition. Of course, insurance companies do this, because if you have a pre-existing condition, it means that you might be very expensive. But in the Netherlands, in Germany, they are by law forbidden to do this. Anybody needs to be accepted. So insurance companies need to absorb the risk that comes from that. And if somebody is without a job or have no means, then the government pays the insurance fee. So that's a sort of kind of combined model. Then there is the what is known as the national health insurance model, which is used in Canada and Taiwan and to parts in France. So it means that the government is like an insurance company. So there is a sort of health insurance fee that everybody has to pay. It goes, the government takes it, but it's separate from the national budget. And if there is not enough money for healthcare, then the fee needs to be increased. so the difference between that and the beverage model is that in the UK and the Nordics, health services are part of the government budget, from which follows that, like say in Finland, the health and welfare expenditure has been growing about 4% per year, even through the recession when the tax revenue has been flat. It means that the government has to borrow or then squeeze out other services like the military or universities or place that in order to pay the health bill. So that creates a lot of sort of fiscal problems on the government level when you have one sector that grows more than the others. So in these national health insurance models, the health money is in a different sort of part, and it is not allowed to impact on the rest of the government budget. Okay, so these kind of arrangements are, where am I now? Here. So this are the, so this is the sort of theoretical explanation to the different health systems that we have in the world. That because the market doesn't work as ordinary markets, there is a need for a third party. So the third party can then be an insurance company or the government or a combination of these both. That the government regulates the insurance industry and that becomes then a sort of third party player in this game. So the setup is such that in the end patients and taxpayers pay everything, but the money is collected through insurance payments. Then the third party needs to give some kind of value proposition and said, okay folks, pay your taxes, don't cheat. Because of that, if you pay, then you are entitled to such and such services, so be happy. Then the third party then pays the service providers, and the way they are paid is a very complicated issue in health finance. We can talk about that later when we talk about revenue models. That's a sort of black art and rather complicated set of incentive systems how that is done. But then also the third party regulates and monitors the competencies and the promises that the service providers make. So this is typically done through the state. So in every country, even in India, the government decides the requirements of qualification for doctors. So you cannot start a hospital just like that. You need to have a permission. And to get that permission, you have to fulfill certain kind of obligations and meet some standards and have the proper degrees from proper medical schools and so on and so forth. So this is basically the setup that we have in healthcare. So it's complicated. This is just a sort of simplification. It's extremely complicated, and there's whole field of science, health economics and health policy studies that sort of deal with these all kind of details and things that are involved here. This takes us to the sort of conclusion of this, that healthcare is different from other services. I think at the core of this difference is the power gap. So the power gap that you have between the patient and the healer or the service provider. Power gap that is deeper and more severe than in any other service industry. And then you can look at where is the power gap coming from. The first point here, as I mentioned, is that many medical conditions are urgent and severe, and people are not able to use their rational faculties in such a situation, and they are agitated, scared, and in pain. Now, by the way, have any of you guys been seriously ill or in an accident ever, taken an ambulance? Nobody. Neither have I. But one of my son once needed an ambulance for an urgent matter. I still remember it was sort of so, I mean, I hope you never need it, but still, I mean, I guess you can imagine the situation, how it could be if you are, say, you get in a traffic accident and you are bleeding and you are in pain and your bone is broken and your body is, you know, twisted in some. Do you think you can sort of rationally calculate, you know? No, you really can't. I mean, you are in a very, very sort of helpless situation at the mercy of the service providers. Then the second point here is that public health is a public good. And this is the reason why the governments get involved in a way they usually don't do in other sectors. Say, your health is a private matter. I mean, if you don't take care, if you don't brush your teeth, or you live an unhealthy lifestyle and you go and catch tuberculosis and you die in a ditch, that's your problem, really. I mean, it's an individual matter, because people are sort of own their bodies and basically you can do whatever you like with your life and your health, right? But if you neglect your health and you die on the street, then you are a public nuisance, right? I mean, who want to see collect dead bodies from the street every morning? You'd have, you know, have the janitors collect bodies like they do during pandemics in the old times. And if you neglect your health and you have AIDS or tuberculosis and you go walk around and you cough, you know, tuberculosis bacillus all over the place, you are a public nuisance. And that cannot be accepted. So that's why, you know, public health is a public good. And also, it's well known that the sort of average health of a population has a big impact on economics, on the economies of different countries, and it has a very, very big impact on military power. So that's why public health, as a government concern, started sometimes in the late 19th century, in the decades before the First World War. And that was because the military technology developed such that you needed these sort of mass armies, a million-man army. And they didn't have motor transport, so the guys need to sort of walk whole day, for days, march, long marches, carrying heavy equipment. So you need a lot of young boys who are healthy. I mean, if you're sick and malnourished, you wouldn't be a good soldier. So that's why the military indeed started all this maternity care and child health programs and various sort of public health things. It's no coincidence that the founder of modern hospitals, Florence Nightingale, she was a nurse, but she was hired by the military during the war between United Kingdom and Russia in the Crimean Peninsula. That's where she made the first observation that led to the first conceptualization of the modern hospital. So it was a military issue. The military didn't want to, say, lose too many soldiers in diseases. It's enough to have the enemy shoot them dead, but not, you know, die of trivial infections. And in a similar way, you know, the perhaps most important medical innovation is antibiotics. And antibiotics were, or the search for antibiotics and the whole sort of effort to get at them started after the First World War, where you have, you know, thousands or hundreds of thousands of soldiers dying for trivial infections because they were in the trenches and there were a lot of, you know, dirt and bacteria and rats and shit around, and even a small wound might get infected and kill you. So there was a sort of need to figure out something to help with this, and that then led through many steps to the discovery of antibiotics. So public health is a public good which justifies government intervention in these things. Then the third point is the information asymmetry. And that's a sort of technical term that's used in microeconomics. And it means a situation where the buyer and seller fundamentally have different information of the trade. This was developed by this guy, Kenneth Arrow, who got the Nobel Prize for this idea. Because this is one of the sort of very fundamental, very powerful ideas that you find in many walks of economic life. A situation where the market place is not equal, but some of the parties is in a position where he or she can know more than the other party and can utilize this position for predation. So Kenneth Arrow, in his seminal paper, he used an interesting example of used cars. Now think of the trade in the car automobile business. If you go and buy a new car, say a brand new Toyota or Maruti Suzuki or whatever, and you have to deal with the salesperson. So how much can you know compared to what the salesperson knows?
Well, yes,
because a salesperson deals with cars every day and he has no time to learn, and he might have been on trips to the factory, wherever. But if you want to know everything that can be known about the Toyota Corolla or the Maruti Suzuki that you think of buying, you can find the information. You can get all the specifications, you can go to the track records, you can talk with people who have used the car, blah, blah, blah. You can inform yourself sort of rather thoroughly. Not many people want to do it, but in principle, there's not nobody who prevents you from massing up knowledge about the Toyota Corolla so that your knowledge is equal or higher than the salesperson. So if you are lazy, then that's a different thing. It's your fault, but you can do it. But then, assume you have you're buying a second-hand car from the previous owner. Now the car is old, so a new car, the quality of it can sort of derive from its specifications and the reputational factor and so on. But an old car, its quality and usability very much depend on how it has been used. So has it been involved in accidents, has it been serviced regularly, has the oil been changed or not, and the wear and tear, and has it been some rust that is painted over or whatever, you know. So this is information that is critical to the trade. Because if the car is damaged, then its value is lower. But the seller has no interest or incentives to tell everything about the car. And this is private information that the buyer cannot get if the seller decides to be, you know, not give that information. So that creates a sort of structural situation where the buyer and seller are in different positions. And so this is information asymmetry. You have asymmetrical relationship in the context of a trade between the buyer and the seller. So this is a serious problem in many walks of life. That's why in many countries, I don't know about India, but in Finland there is a heavy amount of legislation in various situations. Not in the car industry. The car industry or the used car industry solves this by using third parties. So if you think of buying a second-hand car, and you don't trust the seller, then you can contact an independent car doctor and ask that specialist to sort of check out the car and write a statement and say that in his view, as he's a specialist, he thinks that this is okay or it is not okay. And the same is true if you buy a house. But still there is this possibility of the information asymmetry turning bad. So the law in Finland says that if you buy a prefabricated house, the seller has a responsibility for all sort of manufacturing errors for a period up to 25 years. This is rather stiff indeed. It's a sort of heavy burden on the sellers and in fact the prices. But nevertheless, the government has decided that the buyers of prefab houses need this kind of protection. Why? Because you cannot, as a buyer, really monitor everything that happens on a construction site. So you are in a weaker position. So this takes us to another important issue in microeconomics, which is the principal agent situation. Anybody knows this? Yeah, can you explain what it is? Yeah, so can you get the document camera? I can draw a picture of this. Let's assume this is a company. There is some person or family who started this company, and they sort of they own and they manage it. So far, so good. They are the owners, they have the interest of the owners, and they have control of all the daily operations there. Now, then assume that the owner gets old and tired and decides, I don't want to be the boss here anymore. The owner sort of retires, and then sort of hires somebody else to be the manager. And so this is then is the principal and this is the agent. So the agent is hired by the principal to run this thing here to the best interests of the principal. But now comes the problem. The problem is that this agent here has his or her own interests. And they are not necessary because this guy probably here gets a salary, but he's not getting part of the profit. This guy has a budget, but this guy cannot necessarily control everything that is done here. So this here, or it goes here, this is the monitoring. To what extent can the principal monitor what the agent is doing? And by definition, the principal doesn't want to get involved in the daily business anymore, so he can't be there. He doesn't want to be there and check every transaction and go through the books and nothing. He just wants the company to prosper and that it's run to the benefit of the owners. So how is this thing solved? Any ideas? How do you deal with these kind of situations?
Select the most desirable agent.
Yeah, that's why you usually family members. But then if a family member who also owns it, it's not the principal agent problem anymore. Or it doesn't become that because then the agent has the same interest as the principal. Now this needs to be a professional manager who is independent and not an owner.
Actually, the incentive is designed so that is aligned with the best interest of the principal.
Exactly. And That from that follows then all these kind of executive compensation systems that you have read about in the newspapers. That the principal says thinks that, all right, this guy is a greedy bastard. He's competent, but he has his own interests, and I acknowledge it. I don't even suppose he's a saint, or on a charity mission. He's a greedy bastard. He has his own agenda. So let's figure out an incentive system that combines the principal's interests and the agent's interests. And that would be then, for example, you give him some equity. So the executive said, okay, you can buy for a cheap price a piece of this company. So now you are one of the owner, and your income is related to how well the company is doing. Or we can design a bonus system, saying, okay, you get a fixed salary, but then if the company is doing well, then you get a slice of the profit. Or if it's a stock listed company, how the stock is performing on the stock market. So the principal says, serve my interests and I will serve yours. But then still, no, these kind of systems are 100% safe and sure, because there's always this monitoring problem here. That how can the principal know that the agent in every single decision every day decides in favor of the company? Because there are any number of things you can imagine. For example, if this guy is the CEO, he might want to have an extra size posh office and 4 secretaries and 3 cars and a private jet and all these kind of things that are not necessarily to the benefit of the owner, but they are to the benefit of the manager. And if he's a smart guy, he can sort of then hide all this kind of extra expense through and explain, this is absolutely necessary. I'm a big executive, I need to the reputation of the company and so on. So the principal agent problem is there in healthcare too, and it creates a sort of interesting situation where, say, if you are the patient here and you are sick, now you cannot heal yourself. So you have to, in a sense, become your own principal. And then you have to hire or go to a doctor who is then kind of your agent and is then supposed to do something to the best of you. So in a sense, we had discussed with Srikanth about this yesterday. This is the thing of, say the customer can be raw material and also a sort of resource at the same time. So your body is kind of the raw material in the health service process. Your mind is then sort of somehow trying to be in control and manage the situation. But then comes again the question that how can this kind of principle control the agent? What is the monitoring systems here and here that can be used in order to manage this relationship? This is very tricky, and not many people in the health industry thinks like this. But I'm spending time on this explanation because these ideas of information asymmetry and principal agent are very fundamental to sort of all economic transactions in the world. These are very powerful sort of root level conceptual constructs that appear in different shapes and forms all over the place. So it's like the discussion about the Plato's ideas, the bird. That doesn't exist. It's a pigeon or a seagull or whatever. So principal agent constellation is equal to the concept of a bird or aircraft. It's an abstraction that you can imagine in your head, theoretically. It doesn't exist as such in the real world. In the real world, in the same way as in the real world, you don't have birds, you only have pigeons and sparrows. But they have some sort of essential characteristics that are similar to all birds. So in the same way, the principal agent constellations is all over the place. And it's a very useful tool to come back to when you analyze various situations in the real world in healthcare. And on top of that, I mean, there's enormous literature on information asymmetry and principal agent problems. You know, it has been studied from this and that angle in various kind of combinations, and there's a lot of empirical data, particularly when it comes to executive compensation, that gives a lot of sort of hints how you can model or simulate or further analyze and elaborate on these things. So information asymmetry is a big thing here. And then finally, we have the question of risk and uncertainty, as already mentioned. The seller of health services typically cannot make enforceable promises because service production in healthcare is risky and it's also uncertain. Do you know the difference between risk and uncertainty?
Risk, there is a known probability, but uncertainty there is unknown probability. Means it's not known. Probability is not known.
Say again.
Risk, the probability is basically known. There may be bad weather, it may rain, 50%
yeah,
or something. Uncertainty, there is nothing known.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So, to take a simple example, if you toss a coin, right? So there's a risk involved, right? 50-50, heads or tails. If you take a die, and then you can get any number between 1 and 6, right? So the probability space is known, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Some of these is going to come. Unless the dice those sets on the corner, but that's not going to happen. So that's a risk, and you can calculate risks and make risk estimates. Uncertainty is then that anything can happen. So it would be a situation like someone gives you a box, and you don't know what's inside the box. You are supposed to shake it and then throw it out. So there could be a hand grenade that goes off. It could be an egg that splashes on your face. It could be a gold coin, it could be a cat, it could be whatever. I mean, if you have no way to look inside the box and there could be whatever, then that's an uncertainty. That you don't know what is going to happen. So health services, there are obviously a lot of risks. Either you live or you die. There's a binary option. But then in between, well, you die good or you die bad. Or you live healthy and become as good as new after your hospital visit, or you get some conditions, some invalidity, something that follows you for the rest of your life. The pre-existing condition is with you, you know. So there are these kind of situations, and there are instances where there are a lot of uncertainties, particularly say in cancer treatment. So you don't know if the cancer is spreading somewhere, or if it, can it be contained, or what. And because every patient is to some extent unique, then these predictions are very difficult to make. and this, by the way, is a thing that might change with this genomic profiling. Because the genetic setup of every individual is different, and from that follows that different bodies react differently to cancer or to different medications or things. And that, but if the genetic setup is not known, then you cannot make this sort of probabilities there. So how do you do it? Well, as we discussed yesterday with the prostate cancer, you take just a sort of simple diagnostic category and a simple demographic category, say that this is a male, 55 years old, have the symptoms of prostate cancer. But that group is a statistical category that is rather wide, and within that category you have any number of instances, and you try to treat it with one thing, then there's a risk it might work or it might not work. So with genetic profiling, if you can get a situation where every patient is an individual, not only as a human being but also as a biological entity, so you get the individual genetic setup, then that might change, and then the risk and the uncertainties in healthcare could be significantly reduced. So that's, I believe, is the key point with this genetic profiling, and why it's important, which takes us to the next big question.
So here, one thing. Since the patient cannot be rational, most of the times it's a failure of the market. Why you are saying it is partial market failure?
Good point. You already jumped into the next slide where we are going to discuss that. because this is actually a very big question. Namely, if you start from the fact that so far in the history of medicine, the health service sector has been very much defined by the power gap. The power gap has the big thing that, you know, turns around which health services turn, that calls for government intervention and all this kind of heavy regulation and what have you. Now, what if the power gap disappears? Then what would happen? The whole industry would change beyond recognition. And it would be the same kind of thing that has happened in many other markets. You are in agricultural and retailing. So in the retailing industry, there have been this similar kind of radical changes where a lot of the middlemen have disappeared, right? Which is comes through internet and supply chains. And so it's known as disintermediation. So disintermediation in many industries means that this complicated change where you have the manufacturer and then you have the wholesaler and then the next wholesaler and next wholesaler and then you have the retailer. So all of a sudden these disappear and you only have the manufacturer and the retailer. And you have direct connections there that change the whole game. Or in the travel and tourism industry, 20 years ago, if you want to travel somewhere, you have to go to a travel agent. A travel agent, you know, then books your airplanes and the hotels and everything, and then and collects a fat fee for the services of the travel agent. And then you have to pay to the airline company and to the hotel and so on. But now with the internet, you can basically make your own travel. It's amazing what you can do. Once a couple of years ago, I was down in Kerala, and I prepared my trip sitting in Helsinki in Finland, and I knew I need to go to Tamil Nadu to Coimbatore. And I could, sitting in Helsinki, make a reservation on the red bus going from Cochin to Coimbatore. Does it amaze you? Not anymore, but 5 years ago I thought it's amazing. I mean, I can make this sort of detail in a shitty bad bus line going from Cochin to Coimbatore. I can make an advanced reservation and I can select my seat and AC and non-AC and whatnot. So who needs a travel agent anymore? Nobody. you know, so that's an example of disintermediation, that some sort of central part of an industry disappears because some people are empowered and enabled to do things themselves or through different kind of operators. Now, of course, if you follow the travel industry, what has happened is that different kind of intermediators have emerged, like say hotel.com, because it's tedious to, I mean, if you go to a strange location far away, to start surfing the net for the local hotels can be a little bit of a problem. Say if you want to go to Paris, and in the area where you want to be, there might be 150 hotels. So do you want to really sort of go through all of them one by one and then write down the price and the conditions? No, you don't want to do that. That's why there are these internet-based platforms. You go to hotel.com or any other of these, and you set some search parameters, and they select and they rank order according to your parameters, and you can pay and reserve everything. So the intermediator came back, but in a different shape. So the question is something like this going to happen in healthcare? Many people think yes. And this comes back to your question is it so that there always is an information asymmetry in healthcare? Is it so that the principal agent constellation is always there? And I think the answer must be no. Because we have been talking now, I use these dramatic metaphors like shrouds with pockets or people who are bleeding and in pain. I mean, nobody of us have been bleeding and in pain and taken an ambulance to a hospital. So it doesn't happen to everybody. But still, all of you have seen a doctor sometimes, right? Anybody here so healthy, you've never seen a doctor or used any health services? No. Everybody has used some kind of health services, but nobody has been on an ambulance. Except this guy who drives them as a researcher. So what is sort of the real demand structure in healthcare? How many percent of health services are such where you have this sort of steep information asymmetries and principal agent constellations? There is a segment, and that is the emergency DSO, where this is very much true, and it's not going to go away, I believe, anytime soon. But for many other things, you can very well imagine some kind of disintermediation assisted by internet or mobile devices or various kind of new platforms, things like that, that would radically sort of change the whole structure of the industry. And this, I think, is extremely interesting for you guys and all of us, because this is telling us that healthcare is an industry that is about to face a major disruption. And the major disruptions creates tons of opportunities for innovations and new technology applications to this and that. It also creates a huge number of political conflict and resistance. Perhaps the best example of this resistance is the Uber. You have the Uber in India, right? The taxi app and some local. That has been a sort of war. Every step when Uber has, you know, expanded out from San Francisco, it has been forced to fight tooth and nail against governments and local taxi monopolies and whatnot. So it's been very sort of aggressive. Can't think of any other sort of internet-based company that has met so much aggression. And Uber is, I think, successful because they have also been very aggressive. They have all these lawyers and lobbyists, and they are ruthlessly using all kind of political levers here and there to get themselves into the market. But the battle has been quite intense. Why is that? because it's disrupting the existing taxi system as we know it. And if Uber comes, then everybody has to somehow adapt to it. So no taxi driver, or maybe the bicycle taxis are not here, are not affected very much by Uber, but everybody who drives a four-wheeler as a taxi is in a way or another, you know, impacted by this new thing. And the impact is not necessarily positive. In all the disruptions, you have winners and you have losers. So the winners are the people, of course, in Uber's case, the winners are the customers, because now it's cheaper and faster and more convenient to get a taxi. Then the people who drive the Uber taxis, they can earn more money and they can have more flexible incomes and employment situations. But the established taxi operators are going to lose big. And nobody is going to leaving this market without a fight. So try to imagine what happens in healthcare. If somebody comes up with a healthcare Uber or something similar, the doctors are going to fight it, you know, tooth and nail. And the doctors' lobby in India, as elsewhere, is extremely powerful. They are connected, they have money. They have half of the parliament in the pocket. So it's going to be very ugly. But nevertheless, it's going to happen. And when it happens, then the hope is that the winners would be then the patients and the payers. The established producers will be the losers. So that's why I think we need to look at healthcare and possible innovations, and particularly new information devices and methods, tools, whatever. The idea of the power gap needs to be very central. So if somebody comes and tells you about a new service related to healthcare, I mean, I know there are thousands and thousands of them in India. So ask yourself, well, wait a minute, okay, this guy wants to do that and that. What would be the impact on the power gap? So if I were an investor or a venture capitalist in this market, this would be the first question I would ask. Will it have an impact on the power gap, and what would that impact be? In what way would it change the doctor-patient relations? Who would be the winner and who would be the loser? So if you can do that kind of mental calculation, then you would get an idea of what most likely is going to happen. Almost, by the way, just a couple of weeks ago, talked with an entrepreneur in Finland who is exactly into these kind of things. He has developed an application called Meal Logger. It is a mobile app that is used to sort of lifestyle changes, to control lose weight. And the idea is that every time you eat, you take your mobile phone, you take a picture of the plate, and then there is a sort of piece of software that analyzes the picture and calculates the calories, and then it puts on your account. And then if you go do some exercise and something, then you can also log it on the system. So you can sort of keep track of your calorie intake and then your amount of exercise. So the question is, what is this going to do to the power gap? Well, it's not quite obvious, but yeah. Yeah.
Because the health or diseases starts from that, mainly from all kind of unhealthy characteristics or unhealthy behaviors which people do by themselves.
But so they do it knowingly.
Huh?
I mean, they do it knowingly.
No, if means everything is a process of awareness generation. If you were in that process of awareness generation, then day by day, from day one, day two, gradually it will increase. If you want to increase in that path, if you want to walk in that path, then you can start. And if you don't want to, then no one can do anything with you. That's the main issue.
Yeah, but you are correct. But you are discussing a different subject. You are discussing the thing that most sort of investors and innovators and venture capitalists discuss, namely the question: is this product efficient or effective? And that's of course an important thing. Now it's well known that obesity is bad for your health. It also very well known that, I know it personally, it's very difficult to lose weight. I mean, it is a pain. And I can't do it, because if I have to be hungry, then I get irritated and I can't concentrate on my work. So I mean, it is a pain for people who live in this kind of circumstances that we do. And we know also that the best available methods are not very effective. There was a study in Finland about diabetes prevention, and they applied everything that's known on social psychology and group therapy, blah blah blah, and tried to get these people to sort of reduce their weight, and the efficiency was 3% better than a control group that were no intervention, versus 3%. Is that a lot? Well, it depends how you calculate it, because this was a group of people who have what is known as the metabolic syndrome, which includes, say, overweight and number of other issues that predict diabetes. So it's a prevention kind of issue. You know that if you have this and this and this, then the probability of getting diabetes mellitus, the kind of diabetes that hits grown-up people, is very high. Now, if you get diabetes, then what happens? Well, you will have it for life. It requires continuous monitoring. You might need your first medication, and you might need to take these insulin shots. So that's going to be very expensive. From a public sector perspective, the horror is the case where the diabetes is not monitored, the sort of condition, and various complications start to appear. So in diabetes, there are two sort of bad complications. One is that it impacts the blood circulations in the legs, which means that you might lose your legs. So the legs start dying and they have to be amputated. And the second problem is it affects the eyes, and you might get blind. So in a society, imagine a person, let's say 30 years old, no legs, no eyes, and keeps living for another 30 years. How fun is that? How much will it cost? So if you take this kind of worst case scenarios, then 3% efficiency rate is pretty good. I mean, you can make all these calculations. It might be even profitable. So it's worthwhile doing. And then also the question is, what is success? I mean, even a little bit. Even if you lose a little weight, or you stop your weight from increasing, that might be help a lot. And by the way, in this Finnish study with the 3%, the interesting finding was that when the researchers went back to the same population 5 years later, they found that the impact was bigger. It was something like 5, 6, 7. It was a bit amazing, because it brings up the question that what is the exact point in time where you should measure the effect of these kind of things? So it's the same as in, say, in school. When you graduate from IIT Kharagpur, then how smart are you? What is your incoming salary? Well, that's one measure of how well this school has been training you. But then if you look at what's your position in society 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road, 20 years down the road, that the picture changes. So the question is, where is the relevant point where you take the efficiency measure? So that complicates the issue. But anyway, back to the mill logger. The efficiency issue is one. Then the other issue is then that how would this new device or this new software functionality integrate with the rest of the care system? I think that's the key issue. I mean, I would not put my money on any apps. Just making an app and sell it directly through App Store to the general public, that's a loser. There are so many of these things out there already, and very few of them are making any money. So the key issue with this meal logger is that it has to be integrated to a service system where you have patients and they have some kind of nurses or lifestyle coaches that are connected to some kind of health service system. And then this app is used as a professional tool to the prevention professionals who use it to manage a group of patients so they can follow each and every of them and have the records and have then group sessions and discussions and personal counseling and whatnot more efficiently than without this tool. So I think that's where the promise lies with many of these kind of app kind of things. You have to integrate it into something else. Standalone things are not necessarily very smart, but that becomes so difficult. I'm just, you know, programming an app and put it on an app store. Almost anybody can do that. But then you have to start negotiating with the health providers and the insurance companies and sell it to a lot kind of professional buyers who are very sophisticated and they don't take any shit and all that. So it becomes complicated. So again, the same as in the case of Uber, it's not just, you know, software programming. It's not just only, say, having this functionality and this good business idea. You'll have to sort of put it in a context where there will be government, regulators, financiers, winners and losers. And this is exactly the part in this business model canvas, the big box to the left, key partners. So that box needs to be, you know, thought of very seriously. Okay, so I think we can conclude this section. I think the key issue here is the sort of the structure of the healthcare market and the industry is or has historically been driven by the power gap, but the power gap is not forever and it is not equally strong in all aspects of healthcare. And that's why I think the DSO model is could also be used to say that how strong is the power gap in each DSO. We can assume that in the emergency DSO it is the strongest because it's most obviously there. Then it's rather strong in the care, because there you have sort of like in complicated processes you have a lot of doctors and decisions and information that difficult to, but it's definitely weak in prevention, as we have discussed. It's rather very weak in one visit, because they talk about dental cavities and things that are not, you're not in pain. I mean, if you think of your dental stuff, you can be a rational customer. You can think clearly about that. Electives also, because it's a pre-planned procedure that has been done 1,000 times in every hospital, so you can get the data and you can know how good this doctor and how good this hospital is. Projects, I think, are are high, and continuous care is a big power gap because it's long term, it's slow, it involves all kind of things like housing and daily routines that people know very well how to deal with. So it will hit the power gap is different in different places, and that's why also when the power gap is manipulated by innovations, it will have different impacts in different DSOs. So that's what we can continue talking about. All right, we have the break now, because then we move to the next section.